Harper Audio presents Will's Red Coat, The Story of One Old Dog Who Chose to Live Again, by Tom Ryan. This is the author. To Ken and Ann Stamfer, whose love for the White Mountains is surpassed only by their love for each other. After all, an animal is not just a thing with fur on it. It is a complete being. Carl Jung. He allowed himself to be swayed by his conviction that human beings are not born once and for all on the day their mothers give birth to them, but that life obliges them over and over again to give birth to themselves. Gabriel Garcia Marquez. Chapter 1. The Forest. This is the forest primeval, the murmuring pines and the hemlocks, bearded with moss and in garments green. Indistinct in the twilight, stand like druids of old. Henry Wadsworth Longfellow. I woke up early this morning. It was the rain. The way it was lashing at the window beside our bed and thundering down on the metal roof. A few degrees colder and all this would be snow, and we'd be digging out all over again. As it is, the snow has finally melted from our yard, but plenty remains in the shady nooks of the forests and on the hillsides and summits. It is late April in the mountains of New Hampshire, where winter lingers and rivers run high, and the trout lilies and the trillium have yet to appear. Waiting for spring here in the Mount Washington Valley can often feel like an act of faith. It is still dark outside as I sit at my old, scraped and scarred desk, a comfortable hand-me-down from a friend with an old Mississippi accent. A candle flickers, shadows sway, and the scent of cinnamon fills the room. A mug of tea sits next to the candle, and a ribbon of steam rises before fading into the darkness. Atticus followed me out of bed earlier, but now he's sleeping again, this time on the bedding behind me on the floor. His snores speak of contentment, of the early hour, and of his age. Hanging on the wall above the desk is a map of the White Mountains. The two of us know nearly all of these peaks well, and in every season. They are as familiar as old friends who wait for us just outside our back door, and are as much our home as this cozy house is. To the right, a tiny red coat with a thick white collar dangles from a hook. It looks a lot like Christmas, and is just about the right size for an elf. There is a bit of magic in it. Of this I have no doubt, for that little coat gets me to stop many times each day to consider what matters in life, and what it means to be human. That's why I didn't box it up and hide it away in the back of some closet. It's meant to be seen, because I don't ever want life to get so busy and complicated that I forget. No, forgetting wouldn't do. Not that I ever could. A favorite C.S. Lewis quote reminds us, "One day you will be old enough to read fairy tales again." Because of all I've seen and felt through the years, I've come to believe that if we are fortunate, we realize that we can also live them. The mystery of new stories awaits each of us, something that heartens me at the most difficult moments of my life. You could say that this is what I base my faith on. It is the belief that life goes on, no matter what, and no matter how long winter lingers, spring will always follow. The memories clinging to that red jacket are not unlike the fairy tales my mother shared with me when I was very young and sitting on her lap, or the stories my father read to me after my mother died as I lay in bed, too old for fairy tales. Stories of great adventures undertaken by improbable heroes. Those same whispers of possibilities reach out to remind me that many an incredible voyage began without warning. A wrong turn, an unlikely choice, a knock on the door, And the next thing you know, life is never the same. Sometimes even the grandest of stories are launched as regrets. They turn into an unforeseen voyage, taking us from where we are to where we are supposed to be, and from who we are to who we are meant to be. That coat hanging innocently from the hook is a reminder of the importance of letting go and leaping forward, of the depth of despair, the height of love, and the bonds of friendship. My goodness, that certainly is a heck of a lot for one tiny coat to carry. Is it any wonder it is a talisman for me? Sure, I have my memories and all those photographs, but this was his, and this is his story. Well, actually, it is our story. And maybe it wasn't the rain that woke me up after all. Maybe it was simply time to tell it, to tell our fairy tale. I'm an introvert. It took 54 years for me to say it. Yes, I'm a gregarious, chattering, emotionally expressive introvert. People who are just getting to know me don't understand that part. How is it that I am not in the least bit shy, but I'm an introvert? They read my revealing words and see me with Atticus at book events, talking and laughing freely in front of hundreds of people. And they don't get it. I don't blame them. I didn't get it myself until recently. It feels good to come clean, to know myself. When I finally admitted it, I felt like I was on the first of 12 steps. But with introversion, there's only one step. You recognize yourself. What follows is peace and empowerment. You no longer have to try to fit in. You finally understand your social anxiety and why you're allergic to shallow conversation. But I warn you, don't get me started on anything I'm passionate about, like my favorite hiking trails in the White Mountains, the Boston Red Sox outfield with Betts, Bradley, and Benintendi, Watermelon, or the latest volume of Mary Oliver poetry. You won't be able to shut me up. I can also go days without speaking a word and feel the freedom in that extended silence. Words are as essential to me as oxygen, sleep, food, and water. But I don't need to prattle on endlessly like I used to in order to revel in their glory. I can read or write letters to friends or write my newspaper column and blog posts. Words are prayers, spoken or silently ruminated. How, after 5 decades, did I discover that I was an introvert? Easy. It's the way I've discovered many truths about life. The forest told me. Don't forget, this is the fairy tale, and no fairy tale seems quite right without an enchanted forest. It just so happens that we live on the edge of one. When people ask me where Jackson, New Hampshire is, I tell them it is halfway to Wild. 10 miles to the south is the bustling ski and vacation town of North Conway with its outlet stores. 10 miles to the north is one of the wildest, fiercest weather outposts in the world, the summit of Mount Washington. Although I prefer Ogeokochook, the name the Abenaki gave that sacred peak, the home of the Great Spirit. But who am I kidding? We aren't just halfway to Wild. Wild is right outside our door. We walk down the stairs and cross the yard to the bear path that descends beyond the high grass into the tall trees and ferns until we get to the river. We rock hop to the other side, and we're in a magic realm. Within minutes, we enter the White Mountain National Forest, a place the size of the state of Rhode Island. Trails spiderweb out from there for over 1,000 miles. We visit with wild things as often as possible, and occasionally wild things spill out of the forest, across the river, and up into our backyard as well. You see, wild goes both ways. Here on the edge of enchantment, I have learned to be quiet. I can sit and listen to the river's flow, the chatter of crows, the night songs of owls, and the wind sighing through the birch leaves. I've learned to accept the seasons of the year and those that make up a lifetime. I laugh more, talk less, and don't always answer the phone. I read whenever I can and cozy up with one poem at a time, always in search of sublime sentences that stir things in me I may never completely understand. I gave my television away, but music is always playing. Music and laughter abide in this little home. And quiet, of course. Often it's Billie Holiday, or Louis Armstrong, who fills these four rooms with rhythm and soul and provides the soundtrack to our day. I also enjoy streaming WCRB, a classical station out of Boston, particularly when I'm writing, or when I'm in a pensive mood. While not a religious man, I say my prayers more than I ever have, and not just at night. Since I never learned many of the prayers I was supposed to when I was an altar boy, I make up my own as I go. They are more like conversations with God, who plays the role of a friend who is a good listener. In my most common prayer, I list what I'm grateful for. And starting out each day like this reminds me what I have instead of what I don't. Sometimes my gratitude is for grand things like my life or health or friendships. At other times, it can be for something as silly or ordinary as a new toothbrush, or that I don't use an alarm clock. Then again, I don't need an alarm clock, thanks to the three crows who gather in the black ash tree right outside our bedroom window. They define the word cacophony for me whenever I hear their racket. As they caw and squawk and shriek at each other. But some days, I get the impression that they're actually cawing and squawking and shrieking at me, in the hope that I will get out of bed and overfill the bird feeder or leave breadcrumbs scattered about as I do in the winter. For most of my life, I didn't understand the music of the forest, and I was afraid of the song. That's when my friend Atticus came along, and everything changed. He was only 8 weeks old the first time we went into the woods in the western edge of Newburyport, Massachusetts. I had just said goodbye to Maxwell Garrison Gillis, an elderly dog who made his home with me for the last year and a half of his life. His time with me led me to care for someone other than myself or the city I was obsessively reporting on in my small newspaper, The Undertoad. Before Max, there was little more than meetings and politics in my life, and heroes and villains, and above all, stress. One only had to look at his middle and last name to understand how important my small city life was to me. I had given Max the middle name of Garrison, after William Lloyd Garrison, the great liberator, who was at the crux of the fight for emancipation. He was a son of Newburyport, as was Andrew J. Bossy Gillis, the former bad boy mayor, who was infamous at the same time as Boston's James Michael Curley and New York's Jimmy Walker. Both Garrison and Gillis were considered troublemakers who published muckraking newspapers, as was I. After Max, there was Atticus Maxwell Finch. I wanted Atticus to experience things Max had never known, at least not that I knew of. Max came to me with a truckload of emotional baggage, and when I held him in my arms as life left him, he left with my heart. Atticus brought it back to me. But more than that, his job was to live a life so full that he'd make up for the one Max had missed out on before I met him. From the beginning, I treated Atticus as a peer, not a pet. While society wanted him to be my baby or my son, and for me to be his pet parent or fur dad, from the beginning, we were simply Tom and Atticus. I used polite requests instead of commands, and words like please and thank you were of the utmost importance to me. Atticus, would you have a seat, please? Thank you. I talked to him and treated him as my equal, for he was. There was no need for words like master or owner, no need for a collar or a leash, not after the first couple of years, anyway, when he could safely make his way throughout the world with me. Atticus was brought up to be unapologetically himself. My goal was to protect him from the limitations of society and to allow him to thrive. I wanted him to experience everything life had to offer. That's where the forest came in. Max was a beach dog. He frolicked on Plum Island each morning and evening. Other than that, he was on leash as I crisscrossed downtown Newburyport, chasing after the latest stories about misbehaving police officers, lying city officials, and greedy developers. Oh, and don't get me wrong, I also wrote about good folk. Heroes and villains, remember? Max had a good life with me, but I wanted so much more for him.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.